You may remember back in July 2023, I had a bit of a rant about the prospect of sending giant vacuum cleaners to the bottom of our oceans to suck up billions of so-called polymetallic nodules to make a quick buck on the world commodity markets. Of course, everything else that exists down there would get sucked up as well, and the plume of silt that would be kicked up as a result would kill off anything that got left behind, 99% of which we haven't even discovered yet. I thought that was a really bad idea, and I said so. What I didn't know at the time, and apparently nor did anyone else, is that those metallic nodules are not just sitting there benignly doing nothing. New research suggests that they could, in fact, be the main reason why an entire marine ecosystem exists in the deep at all, and removing them could be as devastating to life down there as sucking oxygen out of the atmosphere would be to life on terrestrial Earth. So we should have a think about that, shouldn't we? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. The timing of that original video was deliberately scheduled to come out ahead of a crucial vote at a secretive organisation called the International Seabed Authority, or ISA, on whether to allow large mining companies to go ahead and send their machines down to the depths. If you missed that first video, then you can click up there somewhere to jump back and get the full explanation. But here's a potted version. In many parts of our deep oceans, at depths of more than 4,000 metres or 13,000 feet, there are billions, possibly even trillions, of these polymetallic nodules, which were created as a result of a natural process called precipitation, where minerals that were either dissolved in the water or which made up part of the ocean floor gradually clumped together over millions of years to form these sort of golf ball sized lumps containing greatly sought after elements like manganese, cobalt and nickel, which are of course used in all sorts of industrial applications and millions of lithium ion batteries. The largest concentration is in a region called the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, or CCZ, located up here in the Pacific between Hawaii and Mexico. Just that one area alone covers 6 million square kilometres, or 2.3 million square miles. That's more than 10 times the size of France. Until relatively recently, there's been no real economic incentive or technological capability to go down to such uncharted depths to collect these things. But now, the mining companies tell us that it can be done, using a fleet of remotely operated vehicles, or ROVs, that they say will act a bit like industrial-scale vacuum cleaners to suck the nodules up to the surface. In the run-up to the historic ISA decision last year, the marine mining companies insisted that there's no place for what they regarded as naive idealism, and that deep-sea mining could reduce the amount of terrestrial mining that currently takes place, with all the environmental damage that those industries cause. They claimed their mining activities would cause no significant harm to life in the deep oceans, and that the minerals they collected would play a crucial role in the so-called green transition. But marine scientists, ecologists, and environmentalists all over the world pointed out research that showed that sea life, from tiny seabed worms up to much larger organisms like sea sponges and deep sea octopus, rely on the nodules as an important part of their habitat. Longer-term studies on deep-sea beds where mining has been trialled found that even after more than 30 years, ecosystems show little or no recovery at all from what to deep-sea marine life must feel like a Category 5 hurricane. Losing those creatures, and countless others that we probably don't even know about yet, could have a knock-on effect further up the food chain, the scientists say, eventually impacting even apex predators like sharks and intelligent marine mammals like dolphins and whales. So ahead of the ISA decision, 700 international scientists and marine policy experts signed a petition calling for a 10-year moratorium on deep-sea mining to allow for a much more in-depth and genuinely independent research program into its potential impacts. Companies like Volvo, VW, BMW and Renault backed the 10-year moratorium. Big tech corporations like Microsoft, Philips, Google and Samsung expressed their opposition to any form of deep-sea mining and publicly committed not to purchase minerals from the deep sea bed. And nations including Chile, New Zealand, Germany, Canada and France and the European Commission all called for a precautionary pause or even a complete ban on deep sea mining. As a result of all that campaigning, the ISA committee missed their 2023 deadline to finalise and adopt deep seabed mining regulations and instead announced that they'd be working on a regulatory framework with a view to adopt, in 2025 and stressed that mining should not go ahead until that framework had been fully agreed. And if this latest research paper is anything to go by, thank goodness they did. It's a great title, don't you think? We've got dark matter and dark energy out in space, which nobody's yet been able to properly define, and now apparently we've got dark oxygen going on in the deepest parts of our ocean, which according to the deep sea ecologist Andrew Sweetman and his research team, is somehow being produced despite the total absence of sunlight and photosynthesis. The study was carried out in that Clarion-Clipperton zone that I mentioned earlier, which is where the number of polymetallic nodules is most concentrated. A previous study that Sweetman had been involved with in 2013 had been designed to measure how much oxygen was consumed by all the organisms that exist at the deepest depths, something the science bods call sediment community oxygen consumption, or SCOC. Enclosed chambers were set up on the seabed to surround whatever sea life was there and measure how quickly the oxygen levels inside the chambers would decrease as the wee beasties used it all up. The trouble was, all the data showed that oxygen levels were not going down as expected, but were actually increasing. That's clearly an instrument error, thought Sweetman, so he sent the kit back to the manufacturers to get it fixed and properly calibrated. Then he tried again and got exactly the same result. And that cycle of testing and recalibrating kept on going for another 5 years or so, and the results were always the same. So eventually Sweetman gave up and assumed there was something fundamentally flawed either in the equipment itself or in his experimentation methods. Then in 2021, Sweetman took part in another environmental survey in the same area, this time sponsored by the Metals Company, which is one of those deep sea mining outfits that I mentioned just at the start of the video. Exactly the same methodology was used, with the same enclosed chambers being set up on the sea floor, except this time, perhaps as a result of the slightly different focus of the study, Sweetman had his eureka moment. He realised he'd been completely ignoring the polymetallic nodules that were also enclosed in the chambers, assuming them to be totally inert and irrelevant. But it turns out they're not inert, and they're certainly not irrelevant. Having tested for just about every other conceivable source of oxygen generation in the zone, and discounted each of them as not statistically significant, Sweetman turned his attention to the nodules themselves and found an electrical potential difference across each of them that was as high as 0.95 volts. He realised that this effectively made each nodule into a battery that could cause small amounts of seawater to split into oxygen and hydrogen. It's essentially the same reaction that takes place when I drop a battery into a glass of salty water. I'll pop that down there so the camera can see it. Hopefully you can see there are bubbles coming off there, and that's hydrogen and oxygen gas being separated out from the water via electrolysis caused by the battery. Now, for full disclosure, the battery I'm using here to demonstrate the phenomenon has an electrical potential difference between the positive terminal and the negative terminal of 1.5 volts. And here's where the paper gets a bit technical. It tells us that the oxygen evolution reaction requires an input voltage of 1.23 volts plus an overpotential of approximately 0.37 volts to split seawater into hydrogen and oxygen at the mean pH value of 7.41 found in that region. But it's possible to lower that by several hundred millivolts if you've got metal catalysts like manganese oxides and nickel in the mix, which is exactly what you have got in the polymetallic nodules. The researchers also found large tunnel areas and lots of defect sites in the nodules caused by the natural way they'd formed over millions of years. Those tunnels and defects optimise the adsorption of reactants and enhance conductivity and catalytic performance. So had Sweetman found the smoking gun evidence of oxygen production that had eluded him for so long? Well, like all good scientists, he didn't take the results for granted. He took some nodules back to the lab to do some proper testing in controlled conditions. And sure enough, when they set up the same water temperature, salinity and pH values on a test rig where only the polymetallic nodules were present, they got the same oxygen production, leading them to the hypothesis that the so-called dark oxygen production, or DOP, on the deep seabed may be at least partly as a result of seawater electrolysis, with the necessary energy coming from the potential difference between metal ions within the nodule layers. All sorts of questions still remain, of course, including the exact identity of the energy sources, the influence of different chemistries within the nodule layers, how stable the catalysts are, and how long the reaction can go on each nodule. The researchers also found that their so-called geobattery hypothesis was supported by an observable and measurable link between the amount of dark oxygen produced and the average surface area of a given nodule, which the team attributes either to an increased abundance of anode and cathode sites, or perhaps a greater abundance of what they call high nickel and copper dendritic porous layers in larger modules. Arguably one of the most relevant questions, though, is how effective the reaction is in an exposed nodule compared to one that's been buried under silt. For example, there was a surge in oxygen production when the research lander first arrived at the deep sea site, which could have been as a result of its own bow wave disturbing the seafloor and exposing previously buried nodules to new seawater. If that correlation is found to be causation, then it raises the urgent issue of how sediment redistribution as a result of industrial scale mining down there might affect dark oxygen production in these previously pristine marine environments. And of course, it raises the blindingly obvious question of just how influential billions or perhaps even trillions of those polymetallic nodules have been and continue to be on the levels of non-photosynthetic oxygen production available to the marine ecosystems that have existed for eons in the dark, unexplored depths of our oceans. And surely, that means that until we completely understand that potentially crucial mechanism, we really shouldn't be thinking about going down there and hoovering everything up, should we? The paper itself is open source, which means you can read it for yourself without having to go through a paywall, so I've left a link to it in the description section below here. The main section is actually only 6 pages long, by the way, so it won't take you all day to trawl through it all. Anyway, that's it for this week. A massive thank you, as always, to our amazing Patreon supporters who keep this channel completely independent and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. If you feel like you could support my work here at the channel, then you can find out how to do that and get involved with other like-minded folks, influence future content in monthly polls, watch exclusive news updates from me, and get early access to all my videos by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink. I must also say a huge thank you to the 2,000 or so folks who selected the free subscribe option on YouTube after last week's video. We're on our way to 600,000 subscribers now, and it'd be great to make that milestone in the coming months. So if you haven't already done so, you'd be massively supporting the channel if you could hit the like and subscribe buttons and select all notifications. You can do that down there or by clicking on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.